Yes, I do. I need to get it now.
Well, I can just get sent it to him here.
Was mailed to the office that the board needs to be aware of from Rodney Shea for the work that the board allowed the county to do on his road up there. I'm just going to hand these out. These are just the letter, sample of the letter that I sent out to the people with the tax sale and then the list of all of the tax sale people that they got sent to.
Come on up there.
Nice.
Okay. You can bring your bodyguard with you. Come on,
bodyguard. Sit right up here.
Hi, Dave.
Good morning.
Morning.
This is Jackson. This is John's oldest.
Oh, hi.
So he's helping me today. Yeah. At school off. So.
Good helper.
Of course, I'm here for the Airport Commission.
Okay.
And we got the go-ahead for the ramp, tear out the asphalt for the ramp, put in concrete. And so the FAA made a conference call to our consultant and to myself, and let's say there was a couple of Olson Associates on there with us, and there was a couple of stipulations and so on that they needed to change. Other than that, it was all approved for the go. So Olson Associates has started, with the design and everything. There was the design to remove and replace the ramp area. And along with the FAA rules, we are going to lose 35 foot of the south side of the ramp. So our ramp's actually going to be smaller than what it is right now. It all had to do with the feet from the center of the taxiway or, whatever rules FAA uses. But anyway, so we do lose some of that. But they will allow, as an alternate bid, to go to a taxiway to go to the proposed area for new hangars. So they will also participate on that with the same amount that we're going to lose. Yeah, that we're going to lose in ramp area can be used for that taxiway to the new hangar area. I'll kind of show you a picture. I don't have it. But anyway, along with this, the ramp area, the FAA required the closing of the short grass runway, the east-west, which is 927, which is 90 degree and 270 degree, so that had to be closed. So it made sense for us to put a new hangar area in to the south of the ramp area. I wish I really had that drawing to show you. So anyway, that was, we had a meeting and the Airport Commission voted to go ahead and close that. We actually had that meeting and voted on to close that runway. Then we found out that the FAA required it to be closed anyway. So we were right on the ball of getting things done. So, we do have a number of things going on this year. And the first is the ramp area. The second is to make the taxiway over to the new hangar area to get water and electricity and gas over to the new hangar area so that you know, you can raise and lower doors and so on there. So there's a number of things that we have planned for this year. My concern is so that we are there and ready with the funds from our 10% from the county.
What will that be, do you know?
It's going to be approximately, we got the, there's the AWOS has to be updated, and that's a real important part of our approach system for the airport, rotating beacon. We've got a couple other things that are not really, you know, mandatory at this time. But the apron itself is $490,000. The taxiway to the new hangar area is $136,000. So we're looking, you know, we're looking at needing a maximum of about $73,000 for this next year.
$73,000.
Yeah.
For the county share.
Right.
Okay. They're in the process right now closing out 2015.
Mm-hmm.
And I have talked to the auditors. There's two different figures in our CIC accounting system. These figures need to be resolved. Okay. For your account.
Okay.
One shows 17,000 balance, the other shows 90,000. I don't understand what's going on. So I will get with the treasurer this afternoon after this meeting, and we will we will confer again about this.
I did check with the treasurer, and she told me that there was showing 17,000 in there, where there was 90,000 earlier, but it shows that it was transferred out. So I don't know. Well, it says right here, 2014 budget transfer done in 12/28/15.
Out? Did it go to that special airport, or is that the special airport fund?
That's capital improvement for the airport, is what it says.
Yeah. See, they separated road and bridge out of there.
Right, right.
So, and I really don't care about that. I mean, that's you guys' problem. All I want to know is that there's the local funds, because you know when we sign a contract with the FAA and
you're signing that the funds are available.
Exactly.
I understand that.
Yeah. So anyway, that's where we're at, and we're working hard, the airport commission, to improve the airport, and we're seeing more jets come in for Flight for Life, and it's our airport's become more of a valuable asset.
Right,
it's pretty neat.
It is.
Yeah, I've been working on that for a moment.
Thank you.
Right there, there's where it's yellow land.
What's the cost increase? Is that figured in for?
I know. That's where
that change.
That's where it's in on the 3,000
lamps right there. I came up with 63.5, but. Is that figured in on that date?
Actually, what I've got down here that we had planned for this year was the apron, okay, taxiway area to the hangar, the AWOS rotating beacon.
Okay.
There was a thought of a mower. It seemed like every time they got a mower up there to mow at the airport, that, you know, the blades were dull or there was something. You know, I mean, they use it in the ditches, and but we kind of need more of a fine mower up there for the airport. We thought, you know, if a mower run, a 20-foot mower, run 24,000 is what we estimated, it'd be 2,400 local.
Gotcha. And I didn't have the other figures on there. That was my problem.
And then water, gas, and electric to the new hangar area, which I did meet with Scott with the city.
Mm-hmm.
I would hope that the city would make those lines available at the edge of the hangars, but it didn't seem like there was much interest in that happening. So anyway, I just figured it as having to do the whole thing.
Right.
Of course, gas, it was $8,000 to get it over there. And, you know, the gas company probably isn't much interested in expanding the county there after income for themselves. So that's fine. So that's where we come up with about $73,000 for the...
All right. That sounds good.
One other thing, too, then, which we... Okay, we'd make the taxiway out to the new hangar area. We got some guys that want to build hangars. Then we are going to have to get a lease lined up so that we can say, okay, here is the area,
mm-hmm.
and here is the lease... And here's what it's going to cost you. Sign up and do this. Well, I'm concerned about this because this has gone on way too long. I had the county attorney. I gave her, we own two hangars. I gave her the leases, which are way outdated, wrong names on them, everything else, like months ago. And I've never heard a thing. So these leases, we need to put an urgency on on getting the airport leases to the individuals current. Because we need to know,
I know.
You know, if we should want to sell them or something. Because if I build
now,
a new
Dave,
hangar.
Her caseload is just horrendous. And on top of that, we're trying to get this delinquent tax settled. I mean...
You might give Nicole a call.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm going to have Deb get a hold of her, too.
Okay.
We Rick Rogers, I believe, had presented something to us.
Yeah.
Signed by E.R. Cram, and that's how outdated it was.
Right, right.
So I know she's working on it.
Okay.
So
yeah, I
know
she...
where she's at on it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we need to make sure that we have funds available at $73,030.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
How much?
So I've got $73,030 for this year.
Available?
Yes, that's what we need to make sure we have available.
Well, that's what I say. I don't... I don't understand this entry. Either he has $92,000 available, or he doesn't.
Well, we need to make some clarification.
Well, I had understood that for the year there was $90,000 in the capital improvement fund. That's what, well, I think
that,
I think
that hasn't been pulled over as far as I know, because there are other issues with closing out last year.
Okay.
But the money is in the, or it was in last year's budget.
Okay. Then one other thing too, I think that probably the last thing. We was needing another commission member, and we had recommended Clint Bursch, and I wondered where that was at.
Did we not vote on that?
I don't think we ever made a motion on that.
Well, we'll need to make a motion then.
To accept him.
Yes. I thought we did too.
So did I. Let's go ahead and make another motion just in case we didn't get it down for some reason.
I'll make a motion that we accept Clint
Bursch.
Right.
To the airport authority.
Okay.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All opposed? Sorry.
Okay, awesome.
I thought we did vote on that.
Well, I hadn't heard, and if you did, I didn't hear about it.
You've heard now.
There you go. It's official.
Okay. We will take a look at the numbers.
Sounds good. Okay, I'll notify Clint that he's accepted and on.
I should still be here, because see, here's what tell you got. And this was transferred, and that's what went back out.
Here's 213 showing $17,095. That's showing $95,000.
When he originally came to us, it was like my first year. We got a four-year plan.
Right.
We had money set aside for each year.
Right.
It's somewhere.
Yeah.
So...
okay.
We just got to find it.
That's just no problem.
John Mapes was going to call the county treasurer yesterday.
He
went on vacation. He got back on Wednesday.
I think that's all I've got, you guys.
If we can help you in any way, though.
All right.
Okay.
You got my
thanks a lot, you guys, for helping improve that airport, and we're proud of it. Oh, and by the way, we are getting a... instrument approach from the north and from the south. The FAA has flown that approach. I guess it goes through a process of being published and everything. Mm-hmm. And in December, we should have, we don't know exactly what minimums are, but they're going to be about 250. Okay. Where we're at 600 feet now, so it'll make our airport more usable for IFR traffic.
Especially for evacuation of ill or injured
exactly.
people, if we get that instrument approach.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's another exciting thing that's going on. Okay. Thank you much. Thank you.
Okay, Dave. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
It's our airport of Thanks. Evacuating people in an emergency through the airport.
I'm not sure if it is or not, if it's included in that. I did want to mention, I don't know if you knew, we put our weather station at that emergency building online.
Okay.
So it's on the county website, there's a current weather, so if yours ever goes down, we're close enough in proximity, we could be a backup weather station for you guys.
Okay.
We're logged in with AWOS as well. So
that's
all
awesome.
That
can you get me back where that is?
You say the Jag waiver?
That is just simply needed signed. I got a letter, a notification from Western Kansas. They just need that Jag waiver signed.
Yeah, I just thought you were talking about that. I
printed it and I needed to reread it exactly what it was about.
All right.
Thank you.
Uh-huh.
Chair can sign that. I don't think we need a motion on that, do we?
No, not that I know. I wouldn't.
Okay.
All right.
The museum authority is not here for.
They will be here for.
Okay.
They're going to talk about. They had called me on doing spray insulation in there, and I think that's a good idea because it'll cut down on heating and cooling costs.
I want to start a discussion on overtime.
Okay.
Three departments.
Can we finish this real quick? Like, and then we'll two more things under communications, and then we'll be done.
Okay.
I put in your packets an invitation to the Western Prairie RC&D.
Yeah. Yeah.
If anybody is going, the cost of the meal was $14, and registration needs to be by the 7th of November.
I'm not going to
make
it.
Okay.
Got too many things.
Just as an FYI, and then also. I got a phone call from K-Camp last year. You know, they have that $2,000 risk avoidance grant program.
Mm-hmm.
That $2,000 is available to the county for use every year. She said Cheyenne County has not used theirs yet this year.
Okay.
So the last day to accept it is December the 15th. I've been in touch with Cody, and he said he used it last year. He was going to let maybe somebody else use it this year.
Maybe the fire.
Ryan, that's what Ryan was talking about. He said if Cody's not going to use it, he said maybe we could use it for some of these slides that we have to get people down
the stairs,
down the stairway. If not, I'll check with fire. I'll check with Dave. You know, I hate to leave that $2,000 out there when it could. It's there for our use. So
well, that accessory that clamps on wheelchair so that you can bring a person down the stairs. Mm-hmm. That's another thing we could probably get under there.
Updating light bars on the police cruisers, installing grills on county vehicles, purchasing reflective gear for county employees, installing stay back 50 feet signs from grass graders and mowers, retrofitting old graders with rear view mirrors, paying for risk management related training, bringing a driving simulator to your county, installing cameras in law enforcement vehicles.
Let's update to
them. So there's quite a wide variety, but we'll see if we can't get some department to utilize that.
Which you don't really need anyway, because we're going to come and find you at home.
That's all I had.
Right.
Thank you.
That way they can scare them.
Yeah. I had asked for a printout on overtime dollars paid out for last year, only for three departments. Road and Bridge, Sheriff's Department, and our 911 department are the three. I didn't ask for everything. So as you can see, we've really got to look at future overtime costs.
And especially where you move those employees to hourly rather than salary rates, that's really
It's going to balloon. The other thing is a payroll issue. Currently, there was a decision made some years ago that was incorrect, and we're not paying overtime the way it is intended by the Department of Labor. Mm-hmm. We're paying that person that works on a holiday their normal 8 hours, and then we're applying a additional time and a half. So they're getting paid, let's say they get paid $100. The way the Department of Labor intends it, if you authorize a holiday pay, they get time and a half. But this county's not doing it that way. We've been paying them their $100, and then we're paying them time and a half on top of it, which makes we're paying them $250. That's another thing that's causing this overtime to balloon out of shape. We as commissioners need to make a decision that we follow the guidance as the Department of Labor, not the way we've been currently doing it. I mean, it's driving us, our costs.
And it will be more now that more employees are hourly rather than salary.
It's a holiday pay that's been paid at time and time and a half, though. That's what's, you know, it may be, if you're on a shift, could be $400 a shift.
Pardon?
I mean, if it's a holiday, they'd normally be off. So if they're working, how else would you fix? I just pay them once, time and a half.
If it's a holiday and they would normally be worked.
Well, if it's a holiday, it normally would not be worked.
They get 8 hours of pay. They get, and that's what's set up on the payroll register. When you see holiday pay, it is set up in the system. Like people in the courthouse, they get their normal 8 hour day. But those people that are emergency get their 8 hour day or 12 hour day, and then they get another time and a half. And that's what Rodney's talking about.
Well, yeah, but I just ask him, how do we fix it? What's the solution?
We need to instruct payroll to apply the Department of Labor interpretation. They get paid time and a half, but they don't get
the holiday pay.
Well, it is holiday pay. See, holiday pay is an option that you have. But the option was accepted.
So instead of getting two and a half, they're just getting time and a half.
Time and a half.
Right. Okay,
right.
That's all I
learned
enough.
Right. Yeah, you got it.
I think it's just a discretion as to whether you work the holiday or not.
Right. Well, that makes sense. I mean, I just wanted it clarified.
See what the Department of Labor says on it and use that as a guideline then is what I would say.
Because we got more holidays coming up this year, and if you look at our chart here, you can see numerous departments are already over budget on their personnel. And this just keeps driving them further into the hole.
The majority of the overtime is on our road and bridge. We can't predict any of that. The
discussion is to
address the holiday.
Address the holiday pay itself. So we need that confirmed.
So if I have an employee that works a holiday,
right,
but they only work 5 hours of the holiday.
Well, it doesn't matter. They
they get 5 hours of overtime, time and a half.
Right.
Do they go ahead and get 3 hours of holiday pay on that day?
Yes. Okay. I would say so.
That's my understanding. I mean, that would be my interpretation.
I mean, everybody else that ain't working is getting their holiday pay, so why wouldn't they?
Yeah,
they would get for that remainder of the 8 hours.
If they worked midnight to 7 of the holiday,
yeah,
they'd still get an hour of holiday pay.
Okay.
Plus their 7 hours of time and a half.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you understand it that way? Okay, they come in at 11 and they work a 12-hour shift?
Yeah.
Okay. They get 1 hour of regular.
1 hour of regular pay.
That's kind of where I'm at. Yeah.
And then they get time and a half for the rest of that shift.
Is that what you said? I didn't think that's what you said.
I mean, anybody that's been out plowing snow in the morning don't really give a shit.
They came in at 7 o'clock, the day before the holiday. At midnight, they started getting time and a half.
Right.
Because they're working a holiday.
Right.
They go home at 7. So they have 7 hours of holiday pay. So do they get the other hour to make up for 8 hours of holiday if they're full-time employees?
Well, but they'd have from 7 p.m. to midnight at regular time.
Right, but that's not a holiday.
So, right, they get their regular hourly rate.
Right.
And then at midnight, it hits the holiday, so whatever hours they work holiday would be time and a half.
So you're punishing them 1 hour of holiday.
No.
So you have to pay them that hour from 7.
No, they're getting paid. They're getting paid everything.
No, I don't think you're following what I'm saying. They get their 12 hours of pay, but they are not getting, as a full-time employee, they're not getting their 8-hour benefit of holiday. They work 7 hours of that.
Oh, I see.
So now they're short an hour of it.
But for their emergency services are a little different, where you guys work on different shifts. You're not working on an 8-hour day. You're working, your shifts are 12-hour days. Mm-hmm. That's what your time is based on.
So should they get 12 hours of holiday pay?
No.
They would get...
Well, obviously, they would get 8.
They would... But that's not the way their shift is set up, though.
Well, we're not talking about their shift. We're talking about the holiday they earn. They get 8 hours of holiday pay no matter what, right?
No.
They are earning... They are earning...
If they're
them,
working,
they're earning
they get...
their holiday for the time that they're actually working.
We need to see what the Department of Labor says, and then we can have this argument. That's my thought.
So, if you're a full-time employee, and you've got the 10th as a holiday, right?
Right.
But you came in at midnight and worked 7 hours, midnight to 7 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to give away that hour of 8-hour holiday?
No, they're not giving away any time.
So they should get paid for that hour, even though they weren't here.
They're getting paid their 12-hour shift.
They only worked a 7-hour shift. Midnight to 7, for an example. Midnight to 7 on the 10th. They went home at 7 a.m. They worked 7 hours. That's time and a half, right? Because they worked the holiday.
They're getting paid the actual time they work.
Right. But they're a full-time employee. They should be getting a holiday. They're short 1 hour of that holiday.
It's your interpretation.
Yeah. No, I think that's a board decision. Let's check with the county attorney on the interpretation of, because right now what's happening is they're being paid for 8 hours as a holiday, and then that person had actually worked that, they get an additional time and a half, which boils down to 2.5.
That's not what I'm asking. That's not what I want. I want the remainder of the 8 hours. They should, as a full-time employee, they should get 8 hours of holiday pay for the 10th. But if they work 7 of it, they should get time and a half for 7 of it.
Right.
The 1 hour they should just get for not being
a regular pay.
I see what he means. Yeah. Yeah. They would get their normal pay for that hour because it is a holiday.
We need to see what the DOL says on it, see what Nicole says on it. That's my thought. Yeah. I don't know. You agree?
I agree.
Okay.
No, I see what you mean now. Yeah.
Yeah, that's part of the
truth. Yeah.
Come on up, ladies.
Come up to there.
You don't have to. If you want to, you can come up. If you want to stay there, you can.
It's easier here if you come up.
How are you, guys?
Good morning.
Good morning.
We just kind of wanted to update you on what's happening. For what, 2-3 years we've been working on getting heating and air at the museum, and we were turned down on a grant because we didn't have our ducks in a row, and so we're trying to get together. We're trying to record all that we've done so far. And Robin Riley came to us a couple of weeks ago and said that her Tim's cousin, Jim Hart, had interest in helping us financially, and we don't know how much at all. So he wanted us to just lay out everything that we've done so far to try to get ready.
He was really interested in helping us get the heating and cooling. That's his his goal.
Yeah.
And we know that before that could even be accomplished, we had to address insulation up there. So we have contacted several. You want to go ahead and tell us?
No, well, Robin suggested that we contact Cameron Paxton, and we did. And he referred us to a man named Dennis Malsom, who just happened to be in St. Francis the day that we called him. And he came up and looked everything over. And what did he say, Sandy?
Well, Mr. Paxton said that he does the spray-in insulation, which is absolutely not an option for us with all the artifacts, and you know you can't risk hurting them. So Cameron suggested Dennis, and he came up and he said he his company could do that, like the batting kind of information or insulation. It comes in long strips. Okay. However, to do it, it would take 2 scissor lifts in the museum
in order to
manage those long strips. They're put in place and then there's straps hung across to keep them up there. Well, the things in there are not movable. The rooms that have been built cannot be moved, and there's cupboards that cannot be moved, cabinets, displays. So that, and it would probably hurt the floor. And the kids have painted on the floor, and it would ruin that and also probably crack it more. And
well, and he said the labor, it was so labor intensive.
Yes. So he really was not in favor of doing that. He said it would just be really dangerous, and you know. So he suggested that we talk to Kip Rethke, who does the foam insulation on the roof of the building. And he's done it in several buildings in town.
Well, actually, I don't know that he's done the insulation type. He's done the just the leaks.
Right.
But he's done something on the campus at CSU or CU, and I'm not sure what. But anyway, he's done a lot of it, and this is a sample of it.
This is the roof insulation, which is 2 inches. And well, I think we were advised not to go ahead and put the gravel on top.
Yeah, he didn't.
And it would be a white.
And then it's a rubber sealant on top. We were concerned about whether insurance would cover that.
Yeah, that's what we...
They wouldn't.
They would.
I talked to them.
Okay.
Great, Deb. Good.
I've got a card on my desk that I forgot to bring from a company that was up doing a roof next to my office in Goodland.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Is that... Dennis referred us to a man from who's moved there from Oklahoma City. Do you think that's the same guy?
We wanted him to...
Ask this man.
I've got a plastic see-through card, and I've got it for you on my desk. And
well, that'd be great.
We just wanted to find out if Kip's bid was.
Do you know what the R factor is on this? Because the stuff that they were spraying was a 7.
I don't know if he gave an R factor on that.
That would definitely help, though.
This goes on
my
gosh.
Yeah, it goes on
it
the
It goes on the roof.
Right.
Yeah.
And really, that is about the only option we see available to us.
And I downloaded information about foam roofing, and I could not find anybody else, you know, online. Evidently, the guy in Goodland wasn't listed to give us another bid. Do you think we should get another bid?
I think we probably need to for county. I'd like to see.
Well, and I don't know. Well, do you know how this was $38,000, guys.
Ooh, I know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The building is 60 by 120.
Something like that, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's a large span, you know.
Right.
And then we were toying with the idea what we would do with the front building, the front room, because it doesn't have insulation, but it's got its own heating and cooling mm-hmm. system. And this would eliminate having to find some way to insulate the ceiling of that, which would involve taking the ceiling tile down, and which would have been...
Mm-hmm. And we had had Travis Milne up there looking, and to date, when I wrote this information, he had not been up there to give us... He said he had some other ideas, but he hadn't been up there. But this morning he told me that Monday he'd come up and look things over to see, because he had an idea, but I don't know. Because we've had, like, Dennis Mawson in there saying this is crazy. So, so, I don't know if you guys want a copy of all... I mean, we're not necessarily... You know, we're casting about for finances to support, you know, for this in different directions. I see this.
And,
see
and now
this,
that we know that insurance would
cover
it, that's
good,
too.
So far to, and here's some information about foam insulation.
We're just going to have to pay that out. Right?
Okay.
Because there's a deductible.
I figure, yeah.
And so we'll just pay it and kind of
okay.
get it fixed.
It wasn't that much.
Yeah.
It's fixed and done.
Yep. Mm-hmm. We don't know how they fixed it or when they did, but it was fixed the next time we went up there.
Good.
So. We, Kip comes highly recommended by a few people. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Does this go on top of an existing roof?
I don't know that
what,
there
what
is.
Was the question?
And you
is
know, it is
time limit on the bid.
Well, I don't because he can only do it certain times of the
right.
year, so I don't
so
know.
So it may be when I talked to him not very long ago, it might be something that have to be done in the spring. We might have missed our window to do it now. It has
uh-huh.
to be 70 degrees and
it has to be extremely durable to go through hailstorms.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and
uh-huh.
then if it's injured, they just go and patch that spot.
Which is
nice.
I've got
patching
kind
unless
of like
it's
this
really terrible.
In Goodland.
Uh-huh.
And we just had hail over there like that.
Uh-huh.
And didn't even
oh.
hurt it.
Are you
yeah.
serious?
It's
wow.
pretty durable.
Yeah, and it's pretty amazing. You can
yeah.
walk right on it. Minus
well,
black.
We're hoping, from what has been said, is that this would equalize the temperature in there just by putting insulation on.
It would make
know,
a huge difference.
It would really help.
To
yeah.
make it better
we
for what
we talked a little bit about the insulation. From the roof to the top of our venues, the
mm-hmm.
rooms.
From the ceiling.
From the ceiling. But it's about 10 feet. And so that would possibly be an area that could be insulated inside. I don't know.
With just regular batting or whatever.
Yeah. And that you could get to, that you could do more efficiently.
When it cut down over a period of time, it's going to pay for itself.
Oh, yeah.
Clearly.
Well, in order to, if we would get this accomplished, then we would apply for a grant, and I think we'd have a really good chance, right, Carol? For heating and cooling, and that would really make a big difference up there.
So the total with that upgrade would be $42,000 to $43,000.
What's that?
There was another $3,000 added.
Oh, for
that's
the,
for the gravel.
For, but we've been advised that that's not necessary. So the gravel.
Well, if you're going to write a grant, go for the whole.
Go for the whole
yeah.
thing.
Don't go back a second time.
Well, no, I don't know. I don't know the purpose of the gravel, actually. You know.
Well, I think it was to protect it more.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That'll protect from pretty good hail hits,
mm-hmm.
I'll tell
mm-hmm.
you, with that, that
okay.
additional.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I can't remember who told us that it wasn't necessary just recently. That's
Dennis.
Dennis told
I think he
okay.
was the one that said
yeah.
he didn't know that the gravel
square,
was necessary.
Square.
No, it's square.
And I would
square.
Advise
that's
that, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because then if we get a bad
is it Dennis Mawson?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah, that extra
yes.
3,000, that's a lot of extra
yeah,
protection.
Cameron's the one that told
I,
us about
I will get you the card, but
okay.
I don't think, I don't think the stuff that they were spraying on is going to have your
bad
yes, I would like to know what they are factors.
Yeah,
we will find that out.
We'll see if we can find
but
out.
Anything's going to help.
Yeah.
So.
And well, I don't know if they can measure R factor on that. I don't know. But you said they could. The other
should,
guy
Kip,
said.
Kip should have a pretty good idea.
Yeah.
My
right.
guess is.
Right.
They get 30? Mm-hmm. I mean, that 3/4 inch board's 20.
We, if they would have done the inside insulation, it would have been like weeks to get that done.
Oh, yeah.
And this would be days. So it would be done in, you know, much better time.
Yeah, I think we're outside of their climate.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For now, I think we are.
But we could sure get on the list for spring if,
oh, yeah. Yeah.
If we could
and,
secure
and
the
would
funds.
Be best.
Yeah.
Jim Hart, is he the, Robin Riley's...
He's Tim's cousin.
Tim's cousin that was interested in helping out. I guess if we could find out what he's interested in
yeah.
doing, that
well,
would
well, right,
really
and Robin, I gave Robin all of this information Saturday, and she had a sit-down talk with him in Phoenix several weeks ago.
That is really
And he
neat.
Wanted all this information, so I sent it with her, and she'll get it to him, and so she's kind of our go-between
yeah.
person.
That's neat.
Yeah.
We people, the local people, step
yeah.
up. It's
yeah.
just amazing.
It is, yeah.
Well, I will try to get you that card today.
Okay.
And we will investigate another bid, and then...
Yeah. I, you know, and if the R-factor, the R-factor's a major, major play.
Okay.
I think they were 5-something a square foot, but I think it was only R7.
Okay.
And this looks like it's better than that. And if you want to, you can stop by my office
okay.
if you want to. My wife's up there. Just tell her it's on my desk. It's
okay.
a see-through
Yeah,
card.
We'll go get it right
yeah.
now.
Yeah.
Okay.
yeah. And if you
Do
want
you guys
to.
Want this?
We might get a copy.
I made copies.
Those
so
are
that's
yours.
Your copy.
Just keep
oh,
it.
Yeah. yeah, that's your copy. And I'm just going to add that Travis is going to come up Monday and talk to us, so I have no idea what he'll come up with.
Okay.
Okay.
So you would like us to investigate Mr. Hart and another bid?
Well, I typically we, as a county, we need to have more than one bid
yeah.
just to
exactly.
cover the
and
gap.
We, at
well,
the time
that makes
we
sense.
Did this, we didn't know of anyone else who did it, but now
right.
you're saying.
Yeah. Right. I don't know that anybody else local could. I think
yeah.
Kip's the only one mm-hmm. that does the spray though.
Yeah.
But,
and the guy from Goodland, I think.
Right.
I think Dennis told you that he did, that
yeah.
we didn't get any further information
yeah.
on that.
He was going to contact us and call us back, and he could have. Well, he didn't call my cell, I
right.
guess.
So that's probably the same guy that...
It might be. The only caution I use about using somebody from out of town is when something goes bad, we've got
yeah.
the local resources here.
Yeah, absolutely.
And he'll make it right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So, and I like to keep business in town, too.
So,
you know?
So do I.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of times you'll see people up roofing this time of year, and it always just makes me go, oh, man. Because what
right.
happens is they don't seal. Then they get
yeah.
dust up under that sealant, and they never seal right.
Yeah.
And,
and they're gone.
yeah, and he'll take care of us. So.
Can I, may I borrow someone's pen? Because I just want to remind myself to get the R factor.
And Monday you're going to hear from Travis,
yeah.
you said?
Yes.
Okay.
That's my wife's birthday.
So we just like to keep you guys
Write that down, Brett.
I won't forget that.
Forget that one.
And we thank you for your support at the museum.
Oh, we
that's,
do.
Yeah,
yeah thank you so
wonderful.
Much. And
thank
you
for
the help and
yeah.
getting
yeah.
people to get the bees out of the church.
yeah. yeah. That was a project that was probably never happened again.
Well,
yeah.
I'm glad that we moved.
Yeah.
Yeah,
me saved.
Too.
Yeah.
That
was good.
Thanks for all your volunteers.
Okay.
That's huge. We try to keep a volunteer schedule at the museum. People don't realize that.
Yeah.
So,
that it's all volunteer.
Yep.
And thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Yeah,
right,
thank you guys.
You can
uh-huh.
call me anytime if you need to. But if you guys go to my office, just tell Cynthia it's a clear card on top of it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
You bet.
Thank you.
Let's take a quick break. We're going to take a quick recess, real quick.
Okay.
Yeah.
You need a new one.
Yeah. This place is not working. We live and do with that. Thank you.
That $2,000 grant, if you want to use it, I think you can use it.
Okay.
Because I, from K-Camp, that loss prevention grant every year, Cody said. Unless Dave or Fire or somebody wants
to. I assured them, I'll do it.
First come, first serve.
But I was like you, I thought it was going to go for deer garden. And I really thought it would be for deer garden. Until the county's covered.
The part that I'm wondering about, because we have this, that's what we're talking about. That's what we're talking about.
He was telling me I get so much. I went and bought a snowmobile and they've got like 2 inches now.
So what happens when you get a snow blower for your driveway or something and you spend big bucks to get it
snow? So my kids and I, we go scoop logs because nobody comes in.
Yeah.
Then I need to get a line to get on the table.
There you go.
I knew you'd have a lot of paper.
Well, yeah, and I know she probably printed them out, but I just want to make sure you all have copies.
I know you all have
copies.
Okay.
I had to read through most of them last night on my in my packet because I can't.
I'm sorry this is going to be a long list, but it takes a lot to get a program started. So this is 3 years in the making, so 3 years ago, the rural health care transportation, or the rural healthcare improvement team started looking at public transportation, and then when I started with the county, we officially started researching this program, and we were one of the only three in this corner of the state of Kansas that don't already participate. So KDOT is excited that we're starting. Our transportation vehicle should be arriving by the middle of November, so now we need to just make sure we have all the policies and procedures in place to run the program, hire the staff, make sure we have all the logistics set so we can have a successful program. So this is a list of the things that we need to go through today. There will be more over the next couple weeks. There's a lot to get done. I also just attended the drug and alcohol program training yesterday, and I forwarded another policy that's not listed on this list that I sent you that we will also need to adopt. So Nicole has not had time to review these legally yet. She's been working on the other policies, but hopefully that'll be top on her list. And I wanted to make sure you guys were good with some of the content in here as well. So
she can look over this by the 15th when you want everything. So,
yeah.
Okay.
The drug and alcohol policy that I just got this week, that one we need to have sooner than later because before we receive the vehicle, I need to have my mandatory pre-employment drug screen so that I can drive the vehicle and park it in the station. So we can't accept the vehicle unless I've had my...
You're going to have to clean up your act for
me. I know. So everyone who is in a safety, secure position, which would be the transportation coordinator and the drivers, have to have a mandatory, this is per KDOT, mandatory pre-employment drug screen. And then it will be random testing. It's very similar to what Dave's team goes through. And it's the same company that handles all of the drug screening as well. And the cost of the drug tests are included in the budget, so all of that's been considered. So the first item is Dolores has set up the public transportation fund. It is 140-000. It is outside of the general fund. For 2016, the county match was approved for this year's budget. I don't know where, I think those funds got put into the general fund, but the request was for $17,985. That was approved September 30th, 2015, and it's reflected in those minutes. So now that we're incurring expenses, I would request that we move that $17,985 to the public transportation fund. so that we can start to provide the matching funds that we're going to be required to show that we've provided. So,
can we do that?
I'm kind of restarting the form slot.
Okay. So while she's going to get that form, the next item is that we expect delivery of the vehicle by mid-November. The cost is $58,913. The vendor is Master Transportation. The state will reimburse us 80% upon payment, so 20% is the local match. We will need approval for the clerk to prepare a check for the $58,913 to be signed at the November 15th meeting for the full cost of the vehicle. We will not release the check to the vendor until we receive the vehicle, but they typically require payment the week of delivery, and that's how the state works. The next thing is I would highly recommend that we have a credit card specifically for filling gas in the vehicle that is separate from emergency management. That way, every expense that's incurred on that particular credit card mm-hmm. would be transportation related. It will make our tracking much simpler and our reconciliation on our audit more simple. She had a meeting.
Oh, okay. But we can get her the deal. I was reading through all this last night on hiring three people. I just want to make sure we get on top of that.
I've included in the documents that I sent you guys and that I presented today a job description for the van driver. It's based on the format from
Austin Peters.
Yeah, Austin Peters. So I used their most of their language, and I filled in based on other programs. I kind of borrowed from those. So we would need you prior to November 15th and hiring anyone to approve a job description and a salary range. I included up to $9.50 per hour in the budget. Seeking right now to just start with part-time employees. At some point we may consider full-time, but I thought that with several, at least 2 to 3 part-time people, we could fill up 45 hours per week of driving. Okay. We'll need to cover 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday. So that does include an hour for the lunch. That's where we get to 45 hours. It'll depend on who we hire and their schedules to kind of make this work. I'm hoping to find people who are very flexible with their schedule. I've had at least 3 citizens come up to our office and talk to me about it and ask if we were going to be hiring and what the job might look like. So I know that there's some people interested, and they're very good people in the community. So I know we have some viable candidates already. They would just have to apply. So, and again, everything is, we have to include that employment is contingent on a pre-employment drug test. So if they don't pass that, they're not hired. So, and then I'm seeking approval to run an advertisement to hire up to 3 part-time staff members to cover that 45 hours. I've included a sample language for that we could run. I'd like to know if the county commissioners would like us to have an advertising policy. Some of the programs, they sell space on their vans.
And then that money could rotate back into your account 140?
Yes, and actually that would be, it's part of your overall operating budget, mm-hmm. so they consider that advertising as part of your income, mm-hmm. and the 80-20 split with the state happens after you calculate all your fares, your donations, your advertising, mm-hmm. and then whatever your operating difference is, then they pay you that 80% difference. Okay. So it could help offset some expenses. I could work with Nicole to make sure we have something fair that...
I don't have a problem with that.
No, I don't either. I don't have any problem with the credit card either.
I was thinking about it.
So that one's...
I'm thinking the no-brainer one was hopefully we would get our auto insurance people in town.
Yeah.
to advertise on there.
Sure,
so
would that be
it would be a fee for service, so it's not tax deductible. It's not like a donation. So, it depends on how we write the policy. If Nicole wants it to be tax deductible,
it could be that they donate to get space, but I don't know that we want to go there. I think we would want to be...
But it would be considering buying advertising.
Yeah.
It, so
yeah.
It would be
a business expense for them that they could take off of their taxes as a business expense, but not a charitable donation. So... So that we'll look into the transportation driver's handbook. And I'll let you guys review it. If you haven't had time to read it again, this is something we'd want in place by November 15th. So it's the one that says driver.
Mm-hmm.
Some things I've already talked to Nicole about is this is a position that is going to have a lot of public contact, so we are going to add them into the bloodborne pathogen and all of that, the infection control. They would be required to have a flu shot. They would be required to have a Hep B shot. And the county should, I believe the county should pay for that if we're requiring it as part of the appointment. But that would be your decision, and that's part of that bloodborne pathogen policy that she's presenting.
To do that.
Well, wouldn't that come under your grant fund, though?
It could, yeah, absolutely. That could be part of that budget that we could...
Yeah, usually we take them out of whatever department is getting them.
Yeah, I just want to make sure we include that. On page 5 of the driver handbook, one thing I'd like to include, if you guys are good with it, is that it's at the transportation coordinator reserves the right to request a driver be temporarily relieved from their duties in the event that they exhibit signs of potentially contagious illness or illness that impacts their ability to safely operate a vehicle. So if somebody comes to work, they're running a fever,
right?
I want to be able to send them home because they come in contact with the general public, and a lot of the people that will ride the vehicles would be elderly, you know, people at risk.
Susceptible to high risk of flu.
Yeah.
Or
if they're taking if they're taking medication that makes them drowsy, I want to be able to say you're not fit to drive the vehicle today.
Nicole's going to be the one that can answer that. I don't have a problem with that at all.
No, I don't either.
John, Ed?
Okay. The other things I flagged on page 6, this varies from program to program. How old do you allow children to be to ride the bus by themselves?
Yeah, when I was reading that last night, some children are more mature than adults.
I know over in Rollins County, they let children 6 and under ride it because they let people ride it to go to the swimming pool in the summertime. I think that's asking a lot of your bus driver to be a babysitter for someone who's, you know, 7 years old. That's a lot of responsibility for a part-time employee. Goodland has children 12 and under have to have an adult.
No, or no. Well,
yeah.
I saw.
Well,
and
between
a note.
13 and 17, as long as they have a parent's note on file with our office, that they could ride it. So that's something I would leave to your discretion on, or you can leave that to Nicole's discretion.
Mm-hmm.
What age do we let these people ride unattended? The other thing is, if we keep that age at 12, you're not going to turn this into a school bus.
Right.
I think if you have it young, parents will call and say, hey, just send my kid to school on it. I don't want to take them. So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's not the intent of public transportation.
Yeah.
So... and this is another thing for Nicole to answer, the weapons allowed. I don't know what the law
with
states.
The state law, if they can carry concealed in this state.
But if you have a sign on the bus that has a...
I don't know
well,
that we can,
pro-
I don't think
see,
we can prohibit.
I think the way the law wrote, the people that had the signs on had 3 years... period, but the law was in effect last year.
Mm-hmm.
This is a new situation.
Right.
I'm thinking we
have to take that out.
I think you probably will end up taking it out.
Now, we may be able to leave ammunition in there. They could have a loaded gun, but they couldn't carry a box of ammo. I don't know.
Well, you can't take me to my tree.
If they carry that, they should be able to carry.
Right. Right.
Yeah. I thought Kansas did away with the concealed carry license.
No, they still have this.
I mean, you can still have it, but you don't have to have it to carry
No,
it.
Right. That is correct. Right. That is correct. But there are a lot of situations like what she's bringing up here. This means that you've been through all of the appropriate laws and teaching and training and everything else. So.
Right.
Turns you into a dirty hurry.
Right. But I don't know that we can even, if somebody doesn't have that light concealed carry and they're carrying, I don't know that we can prohibit. So that's something for Nicole to answer for us.
I think that'll end up coming out, but.
I need to work with Nicole on getting a release form if the rider refuses to buckle up. Mm-hmm. Right now I'm saying that they should be asked to leave the bus. I don't know if we want to...
She's probably going to have a waiver, be my guess, because I think I would open a can of worms. When I was reading through that last night, I was like,
what do the wheelchair people do? Do they have a buckle thing?
The wheelchair people, we actually have restraints for the wheelchairs, and ADA only requires us to... the maximum weight is 650 pounds between the individual and their equipment. So if, and it's one of those things where you have to eyeball it. If you think somebody's going to go over that, then that's on the next page, page 7, we may need a waiver for that too. Because if they break our lift, we can't get them up because the lift won't go up, it releases us from liability that they get injured when we put them on that lift.
When you shut them off to live.
Yeah. And page 8, again, I've asked for a company credit card for this, that they would have to comply with the credit card policy. And stating that the driver is responsible for any charges made on the card while in their possession that's not covered by the credit card policy. And I would have a sign out form so I know who has the credit card at any time. Mm-hmm. So,
would they need to have a special instruction for gas and oil? So, or do you already have?
I think it would adhere unto the company policy. I think the overall credit card policy would apply there too. If we end up going regional and they have to have meals, they couldn't use the company credit card for the meal. They would pay for that personally and then turn it aside.
Well, because we get mileage, and that's why we can't have gasoline. But in this case, it's a county ban.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
And that's covered in the credit card policy.
Yes. Yeah.
So. Accidents. If they actually have an accident, this is the procedure. The drug test, they would be required to have an alcohol and drug test. I didn't know if that wanted to be the human resources department that would get involved there, or if you wanted it to be the transportation coordinator. So whether it's the clerk's position or my position, if there's an accident and there is injury that requires medical attention, it disables either vehicle, our van or the other van, or there's a death. That driver has to immediately be taken in for a drug and alcohol test. So it would either be the clerk or me that would have to come in, and you stay with that person until they've had that. So we just need to identify which position should do that.
Well, and through our work comp, I have a report that needs to be filled out to send in, and then work comp people.
So it may be the human resources person that does that.
And that needs to be reported immediately. And they'll come in and investigate.
Yep. And that's part of it. We have to complete all the necessary paperwork. But it's really who is going to stay with that individual until they've had that. So, and we can defer to Nicole's opinion on that, too. Okay. And we would just have to make sure that this person is with them, because for the KDOT program, we are required to stay with them until that has been performed. So. And then on page 12, that I already talked about, and Nicole agrees with me that we should also add the Hep B shot in addition to the flu shot. We can require that. And if they don't want to do it, they're not eligible for higher is what her opinion was. So
it's required by DTE, Kansas.
It's not required by KDOT, but I
suggested perhaps.
It's in some of the other handbooks. Yeah. Some of them have it. I just, we're such an elderly population.
Well, it makes sense. It really does.
They're going to be holding somebody's hand or grabbing their arm to help them on. Yeah. They're going to reach down right in front of their face and buckle them. So they're going to come in close proximity. So the rest of that, I think, was pretty basic and pretty straightforward, unless you guys had any questions. If you want to make any changes to this, you know, you can email me or we can go through them.
On your job description, where you say classification, non-exempt, part-time, I think a grant position would be classified as non-exempt temporary. Now, the reason is part-timers are eligible for certain benefits. Temporary or not.
Okay, and is that going to be a temporary or is it going to be...
Well, the grant is for how many years?
It's annual. We renew annually.
Okay.
But I believe the Kansas Labor, if you have someone who's in a position for more than 36 months continually, they are part-time. It's not temporary at that point. The intent... KDOT's
but it's been, still being paid out of the grant.
Yes. Well, but there's also a county match, so it's not entirely grant-funded.
See, now you're getting into personnel. That's why I'm questioning here.
And we can talk with Nicole and with...
Yeah. My suggestion simply is because of the changes that are coming up on December 1st.
Mm-hmm. If it ends up being a long-term program... and you have the same person that's in that position for more than 36 months continuously, then you have to pay them back some benefits. I would rather just do it on the front. I mean, the closest thing, I think, the only thing they're really entitled to is CAPERS.
How long has Sherman County and Rollins County been doing it?
Rollins has been doing it for 3 years, and Sherman's been doing it for almost 10.
Have they had any trouble with the renewals?
None.
Okay, so chances are we're not either. So
KDOT does not predict a cut this program.
Okay, so basically we are going to be running it for a long, well, hopefully forever.
Yes.
So if
the person is designated as temporary, we don't have to worry about future paybacks. But if you designate them part-time, you're getting into a different category.
Right. And then, but there is that risk if you designate them as temporary and then they work more than 36 months.
Sure.
So I would want to run that by Nicole. Just protect us. If it was just like the rural health care grant where we had a 3-year grant and it may be over, that would be different. This is hopefully going to be continual.
And there will be a county match each year.
Yes.
Now, this match of... 17,000. That includes the wages for this year?
Yes, it does.
Okay. And any other?
It includes
ancillary.
It's the entire budget.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions about job description or driver handbook?
No, that's the only thing I noticed last night when I was reading this.
Okay. On the rider handbook.
I'd read on one of these at 30 cents a mile.
Yeah, that's on the rider.
Aren't we 52 cents or 54 cents?
That's the personal reimbursement.
Okay. Right. I didn't know if we wanted to.
Yeah. This was a pretty, so if we go to the rider handbook and you go to page 3 and it talks about fares.
Yeah.
So this is what we came up with. We had a group of 21 people as a task force. And originally we were kicking around, do we charge people, you know, like a dollar or 50 cents or something? What do we do if they want to travel out of county? There was a lot of concern that people were going to use this to go to Walmart and go shopping and take tax revenue away from St. Francis. So the task force all agreed at the end, not necessarily everyone agreed, but we agreed to disagree and move on.
Okay.
that the best way to approach this would be a donation-based, if we stay and travel within Cheyenne County. That would encourage people to do their business in Cheyenne County, to shop here. We get the tax revenue, get people to our hospital, our clinic. If they wanted to go out of county, because KDOT highly encourages us to allow out-of-county travel so that we can be a like a seed place for a regional program down the road. But we could charge them if they wanted to go to Sherman or Rollins a $25 fee. Because their adjacent is probably going to be Atwood or it's going to be Goodland.
Okay.
Maybe McDonald's. McDonald's to visit. If they want to go beyond that, then we get into the mileage fee. And at 30 cents a mile, it's staying consistent with that $25 fee to go to Goodland. It's not going to gouge the person. We may have people who need to go to Hayes for an outpatient visit. I did add in there a limit of 200 miles. And the reason we did that was to get there and back.
Denver is 160.
Well, we can't go out of state right now.
Oh, okay.
KDOT will not let us go out of state at this
time.
Okay,
so we'd have to go to Hayes.
Yeah. So we could go as far as Hayes, maybe just a little bit farther, maybe to Russell. But that way the driver is still working an eight-hour day, basically. 3 hours there, 3 hours back. They may have a little time waiting. Keeps them in that eight-hour shift. So,
I just wanted to make sure.
So I didn't know if you guys were good with that.
It's fine with me. I just didn't know.
Yeah.
Okay. And because we do accept donations, we'll track that. One thing I had written in here for the driver on how they handle the money is at the end of every day, by 5 o'clock, they need to bring any money collected to the treasurer's office, along with the rider report.
Are they shutting down at 5? Is that?
Yeah, they're 8 to 5. Yeah. Okay. I didn't know if that works for you or if you would rather they bring it in at 8 o'clock the next morning.
They can bring it in and we can keep it in our vault. Okay. And just process it in the morning if that's okay.
Because I would rather not
keep. Because we will be hopefully balancing by then. Hopefully.
This first year, the hospitals agreed to do the dispatch. So we have that cell phone number.
Okay.
It will be routed to the hospital's business office. They'll answer the phone. They'll do the dispatching. And again, page 4 on that is that whole question about what age. And the lift waiver, a lot of this is pulled straight from the driver handbook. This is just what we would hand out to the public. So those are pretty much it. The fares was the main thing on that one I wanted you guys to see.
Okay.
I'm going to get a lockbox. Because it's on a public vehicle. I want it to be locked. So.
That's pretty good.
Okay. Rodney. We probably need a motion to have her run an ad for drivers.
Pardon?
I think we're going to need a motion to run an ad for 3 part-time drivers.
Yes. Well, if it's under the grant, the grant's paying for it?
It's paying 80%.
So we're still paying
20. We paid and reimbursed?
Yeah, it's all,
okay,
this is 100%
we'll need a motion. Yeah. Okay, I'll make a motion that we advertise for part-time driver
for how many weeks? 3 part-time drivers.
3, yeah.
Up to 45 hours per week.
Probably about for 2 weeks.
Okay.
You think that okay? 2 weeks?
Yeah. Okay, for 2 weeks.
Okay.
All right.
All right, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Right. Okay.
Sure.
Are you going to contact Karen?
Does she have a copy of this?
Yeah. I'll get Karen a copy of that.
Okay.
So
all right.
I'll email it to her. And then I didn't know if you need to make a motion about the credit card.
That we probably will as well.
So that Deb could get started on getting that process.
And I'll probably set it up under your name. Set it up as a transportation. Public transportation.
Yeah.
And put your name on it.
That'd
probably no reason to have the maximum over 500, would there be on a day? Okay.
It's just going to be gas. Okay. That's all they know.
Yeah, there shouldn't be.
That's what I was thinking. Do you want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we authorize a credit card for the public transportation program not to exceed $500.
Okay.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same side.
Now, you know, we may have to raise that because of the cost of gas. We're talking about a month now, aren't we? Well, yeah. We pay every no, 2 weeks.
Per transaction.
Per transaction, I thought, or per day, I thought.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's per transaction.
Okay.
The only thing I would see is if there was, like, you went to Hayes and they had a breakdown.
Yeah.
Mechanical, but I'm sure we could work something.
We would probably try to work in at 30 with the...
Well, yeah, to the trucking company, just make a call to the dispatcher, where this would be.
Yeah.
Say it, thank you.
We'll make a $500 payment every day.
I'd have to get approval for them to spend that much to repair it anyway,
yeah,
so.
Right.
So the other things, after Nicole's reviewed them, I'll come back and get on the agenda to get policies approved. The contact information for the drug and alcohol policy, wanted to make sure you guys were good with me being the primary, Deb, or the clerk's position being the secondary, Nicole as the attorney the third.
Okay.
So if you're good with that, then I just need your signature at the bottom. But.
Good.
Just some points of...
Is that a
it's going to be... Yeah, and it's going to actually be in this policy. That's what they based that contacts on in there. It's the mental health center, is what TMHC stands for.
Yeah.
We'll need to start running monthly advertisements starting in November. I have a budgeted $750 per year. Just informational, because the individual ads will be less than $500. So just wanted you guys to know we'll start advertising that program. And as soon as we get the vehicle, I will request the St. Francis City match. They've approved $10,700 for 2016. And
for 16?
Yeah, for 16. And then
but
they
Bird
also,
City didn't.
Bird did, City did not.
Not for 16.
Okay. Not for 16. Bird City Century 2 has approved 5626 for 2017, and the City of St. Francis approved 8439 for 2017. So once we start that, though, I'll request the 10700 from the City of St. Francis that can go into the public transportation fund. And... the vehicle being parked, originally the city or the Century 2 Foundation had offered the Prairie Land building over in Bird City, but it doesn't have utilities. And so in the wintertime, it gets very cold, there won't be a place for the employee to actually work because they will have paperwork they have to complete. I talked to Reed, and there is room in St. Francis in the emergency bay on the ambulance side that we could park it there. And we do have a little desk in Ryan and my office that the driver could use. So I want to make sure you guys are good with us putting that transportation vehicle at the emergency building in St. Francis.
I have no problem.
I don't care.
It'll help me better supervise the program happening there anyway. So.
Yep.
I think that's it.
Okay.
It's a lot of work to start a program, but I think it's going to add a lot of value to our citizens. So.
You need a motion to get your drug test done.
Well, that, I think you need, this you need to wait until Nicole reads it. I don't feel comfortable having you guys adopt the policy.
Well, I meant you said you had to get a drug test before you go pick up this.
Well, I do, but you have to wait until you approve this policy. And I would rather have Nicole review that before you guys sign it. It's KDOT's base template, so I don't think she's going to have any issues with it.
Okay.
I mean, if you guys want to approve it today, you can, but I'm assuming you're going to wait.
I agree with you.
We'll wait. So,
thank
that
you
is all I need.
Okay.
I have a copy of this packet if you want.
Morning.
It's going to be easy compared to that.
Thank you.
Listen.
spring oil. So.
With Carol's working with a transportation program, I asked her to contact the alcohol and drug testing place to see if they would have a program for EMS. They call this their non-DOT program. The gist of it, it's basically the same as her as far as random drug testing, pre-employment testing, after an accident testing. It would run the EMS department $100 per month to implement a program like this.
And that covers everybody.
Yeah, that would cover all of our volunteers. That's up to 20. At any time, we're about 20. That does not cover their pre-employment. That's all in the after accident. Anytime you have an actual test, it's $75 as outlined on page 9. Their random program is the one that's $100 per month. And what they do, I guess, is they would take our 20 people and throw them into a bigger pool, and then that's how they pick their random. So it's not just that they're out here all the time with our 20 people picking random. We go into a big pool. We have had an issue with that in the past that I wish we would have had a program in place. We do have... You know, EMS is a little bit different. We do have access to the Schedule II narcotics that do show up on the drug tests. I think that would be something, from a liability standpoint, you guys might be interested in doing. There's no state regulation or a DEA regulation that says we have to have this in place. Something for you just to discuss at this point. But,
so
yeah.
This could go in hand with the blood pathogen. No, it wouldn't be blood pathogen. It'd be in that area. But pardon?
Anytime you have somebody driving a county vehicle.
Right. They have to be tested.
If we have something like this in place for your department, would that lower our insurance, you think?
If I was insuring the county, yeah. You know, I think that's something to really look into and ask them. I mean, there might be something there.
Because as long as the county does the driving, you know, partakes in the drive, and that's something else with KCAM on your drivers to go through a safety driving class.
This is $100 a month for the program.
For the program, yeah. For EMS.
It covers 20.
It says here, county. And I was thinking if we're going to have it,
well,
maybe
I know.
We ought to have it for the whole county.
But Dave's department already pay these people for road and bridge employees.
For road and bridge.
So, but it just hasn't.
I think it's a good deal to have.
Well, it's a good thing, but I guess what I'm getting at
is
maybe we
the
combine.
Handbook?
Road and Bridge and him, and we have a single program for both departments.
Program. So their policy is slightly different, and the public transportation is slightly different, and then they have us non-Department of Transportation for the rest of the employees. So Reed's group and the sheriff and, you know, the fire, they could all fall under this non-DOT. But Dave's is very specific on what his covers. Mine is slightly different, and that's mandated by the FTA. So, but you could have a non-DOT for everyone other than Dave, Public Works, and Public Transportation.
Okay. What it comes out to is $5 per employee per month.
Yeah. But we'll probably need a motion if we want to adopt that because it's $1,200 a year.
Do you want to start with just his department, or do you want to go straight to a county program for this?
Let's just start here for now.
Pardon?
I think start here for now. We're going to have to adopt it with other departments. Yeah.
All right.
One of the things that is a little tricky with us, and I think fire would have the same problem, is when it's the volunteers. For us, how we'll define that in policy is if you're on the schedule, you would be subject to a random drug test.
If you're off the schedule, you wouldn't be.
Looks like 90% of them are urine tests, so it's no big deal.
Yeah, but that's how we would conquer that issue with, you know, they're not subject to testing 24/7, 365.
Yeah.
But when they're on call, they would be. And I, although it's not in my budget specifically, looking at where I'm at with the budget, I don't see why it'd be an issue for next year, $1,200 a year out of contractual.
I'll make a motion that we implement the drug and alcohol testing program from TMHC Services in the amount of $100 a month or $1,200 a year.
Yeah.
For the ambulance service.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same
sign. Thank you.
Thank you.
The other thing is keep you updated on shift bids. Shift bid total for September was $5,130.75. And the only other thing I have is our main printer up there needs repaired. So it needs a new laser assembly and a new fuser assembly for a total cost of $324.90 with shipping. I can buy a new printer for $567.40. The one we have up there's printed 101,000 pages and sent 3,200 faxes over its life, so I think we got good use out of it. But yeah, it's less than half for a new one.
We ought to authorize a new printer.
We'll need a motion on it because it's okay. Over 500.
I'll make a motion that EMS purchase a new printer.
I don't have a
wish. In the amount of 500 and what?
Can we say not to exceed 600?
Okay, not to exceed $600.
That should get it shipped here.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Okay.
That's really all I have, unless you have something.
No. Thank you, Rachel.
Just go away.
I told you I was going to be easy.
You're up, Amanda.
Real quickly, before we go any further, can we have a motion on that transfer?
Yeah.
Transportation. That's the new form that she printed out.
I thought we already made a motion.
Not, well, you said, yes, it's okay to transfer that. Those transfers need to be done by motion.
Go ahead.
Okay. Make a motion on transfer of funds from County General to Fund 140 Public Transit in the amount of $17,985.
The county match.
Okay.
Sorry.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same side. Okay.
You better say aye. We have signed it.
I would like to request 10 minutes of executive session to discuss non-elected personnel.
Okay. I'm going to make a motion for executive session for non-elected officials.
Mm-hmm.
Non-elected personnel. Mm-hmm. How long?
10 minutes.
10 minutes?
Double S. Okay. Do I say?